imam utisak da je hub zajednica narasla do izvisne mere kada već postoje 15 ideja koje se ovde razvijaju, da međusobno nismo imali dovoljno prilike da se čujemo i nadam se da ćemo iz današnjih događaja izaći sa nečim da će jedan tim moći da posavjetuje drugi, a što da ne može doći do neke nove ideje. Danas imamo 8 timova, 9 koji će da se predstavi. Jedan od timova je baš danas i lansirao aplikaciju. Sinoć nisu spavali, pa sada dovršavaju ovaj poslednji slajd za prezentaciju. Ali pričao sam i sa ljudima koji su radili u stvaranju, ono što mi zovemo kao prva generacija Huba, jeste da se desilo preko 30 radionica, preko 20 većih nekih skupova, gomila nekih ljudi koji su vezani za tehnološke kompanije su imali priliku da rade s vama, da vas savjetuju, nadam se da su bili od koristi, i sada smo već u prilici da polako rezimiramo rezultati, da pravimo neke planove za budući, da širenjem ICT Huba, širenjem te mreže mentora, širenjem broja ljudi koji žele da se bave preduzetništvom, napravimo solidnu bazu koja će kasnije da rezultira tehnološkim kompanijama koje zapravo neku zapošljavaju i stvaraju neku dodatu vrednost. Za nas kao hub bi možda bio i najkompleksniji, ali i najznačajniji događaj u smislu organizacije, u smislu nekog znanja koje je doneto u ceo ekosistem koji se bavi startupima, jeste dolazak investicionog fonda 500 Startups. Čini mi se da je to bilo korisno ne samo za timove koji su imali prilike da rade sa njima, već i za ljude koji rade upravo sa startupima, jer mislim da smo sa njima uspeli da napravimo pre svega dobru komunikaciju sa timovima, sa ljudima iz San Francisco, gde zapravo dakle sve kreće, svi neki novi trendovi, neki novi pravci, ali i da definišemo šta je to potrebno domaćoj sceni kako bi se ona dalje razvijela, i nešto što je, da kažemo, zvanična najava naša za ubuduće, to je da ćemo raditi mnogo više na inicijalnoj trakciji, na tome da timovi koji rade iz ICT Huba postignu vidljivost mnogo brže, da mogu brže da skaliraju, da mogu brže da pravi iteracije, samim tim da brže napreduju. Mislim da tehničke veštine su sada mnogo manji problem od onih koje su zapravo kako u svetu ovako masovnih i brzih komunikacija, kako zapravo doći do nekog ko će hteti vaš proizvod da koristi. To je nešto na čemu će biti i naš fokus. Da ne dužim dalje, mogu bi da sada pričam dugo o nekim našim planovima, a poenta je da se međusobno čujemo, da čujemo ko na čemu radi. Pre nego što Alex krene da najavljuje timove, volio bih samo da pustimo, ako neko od vas nije video, i film koji je zabeležio trenutke posete ekipe iz 500 Startups. Tako da hvala, toliko od mene.
A lot of my friends have been to Belgrade and they've been saying really nice things about it. And like when Dominic and a few of my friends were like, hey, they're gonna go visit Belgrade and meet startups and founders and like hang out. It's like, hey, that could be a lot of fun.
And they wanted to do a workshop on growth and startups and entrepreneurship.
And so I came here with two colleagues of mine from 500 to, you know, who are both growth experts and ex-founders. I come from the investment side.
500 Startups je jedan od, recimo, po svim parametrima top 5 investicionih fondova i akceleratora koji investiraju u jako mlade kompanije. Investirali su do sada, su investirali u preko 1000 kompanija i investirali su, čini mi se, nešto preko 100 miliona dolara.
Oni su investitori, oni znaju šta drugi investitori žele da vide u pitchu.
Preko 10 timova, ako se ne varam, imalo priliku da radi direktno jedan na jedan kroz mentorske sesije sa ekipom iz 500 Startups. Praktično 3 dana intenzivno radili sa timovima, što iz huba, što sa strane.
There's a real like hunger and openness to sort of new ideas and feedback. I think there's a real hunger for like knowledge.
Every scene is a little bit different, but they all have common kernels.
It kind of echoes what I'm seeing in a lot of other countries, where you are seeing progress everywhere.
So like really smart founders that are great engineers, but even in Silicon Valley, the things that founders suck the most is sales and marketing. So we've been asking questions and trying to understand their business and then leading them in the right direction.
The main conversations that I had were around how do I unlock growth or how do I find customers.
Veoma je bitno da startup zajednica izađe iz okvira Srbije. Startup se ne odnosi na Srbiju. Startupovi iz ICT Hub-a se ne odnose na srpsko tržište.
You have good talent at speaking English, and if you actually shoot for global companies, you can actually have a significant advantage even compared to Silicon Valley.
The hardest challenge that we have in San Francisco is competing with big companies like Facebook and Dropbox, and et cetera, on finding great engineers and technical talent.
We can't hire enough engineers, and the engineers that we can hire are really expensive.
I think out here, there's a lot of fantastic technical talent, but they might not know about sales and marketing and traction and early stuff. So I think that this kind of like hub is a great way to get people into like that vibe and start building teams that really gel together.
Something that attracts entrepreneurs. Very valuable, because a lot of times like founders best learn from each other.
We had a conversation with several business people earlier, and I think there is starting to be this mentality of how do we think about making the entire ecosystem sort of like better.
ICT Hub, you know, plays a very important role in the ecosystem. It's a very, very early stage where people with ideas can come, they can exchange ideas, people can support each other. You have an amazing working environment, and now you can see people like 500 startups are coming to look for opportunities here.
Ovo je sjajna baza, ali moramo svi zajedno da podržimo ovakve projekte, da ne odustajemo od ovoga, da ovo zaista zaživi. Potrebno je angažovanje svih ljudi koji su u privredi na ovaj ili onaj način i da ovim mladim ljudima da im damo potvrdu da nisu sami, da stojimo iza njih.
I actually found a company I actually really want to invest in that wouldn't have happened like 2-3 years ago.
Ćao svima. Naša prezentacija će ipak biti na engleskom, tako da počet ću. Hi everyone, we are Adrenaline Map, and we are crazy about extreme sports. We live and we breathe longboards. We have even founded a Serbian longboard community. By being a part of this community, we have identified few problems that expands to every longboarder in the world right now. Where can we find locations to ride and how safe those routes are? Currently, there is more than 3 million longboarders around the globe, and the whole industry is making around $2 billion annually. Longboarders can be found in the groups in the whole world, so we are aiming for a small yet very strong niche. Since we are an experienced software developers, and we came up with our solution, which is a longboard map. It's a place where our users can view, find, record, and share routes around the globe for free. For each route, we display the detailed information, like speed, difficulty, road quality, and traffic intensity. And to keep our users engaged, we have implemented a real-world gaming mode where users can compete against each other. We have launched our app, ovo izgleda stari neki pitch, ali dobro. We have launched our app in February this year, and right now we have 5,000 downloads, not 4,000. And iOS launch, web app, and the wearable support is scheduled in a few months from now, and we plan to be market ready by the end of this year when we implement our business features. There are a few competing products on the market. Some longboarders are trying to use these fitness apps like Strava, but these apps simply lack some important information longboarders need. There are two more longboarder apps on the market. Free one is very terrible executed, and the second one resulted in only 50 downloads in more than 6 months period just because of its price. Since paid app clearly isn't an option, we have decided to offer a brand a unique way to increase their brand's visibility by allowing them to use advanced analytics and our centralized shop. By entering a longboard market, we have only scratched the surface of extreme sports industry. There is more than 85 million active participants worldwide, and we plan to enter those markets in upcoming years. Thanks, this is not me.
Hi guys, I'm gonna present our project and our startup, and it's called HiRap. So the main thing is that we identified a problem on the part-time job market in the US, and the main problems are that market is very slow, it's completely outdated, it is very inefficient because of its slowness, and 4 out of 10 employers cannot find suitable candidates to work part-time jobs. The second thing is that more than 60% of companies, small and medium enterprises, still use Craigslist as their main source of finding part-time employees. Even Uber and Lyft, as startups, they use Craigslist to find part-time drivers, and that's a big market. And some businesses even use door signs to find them employees. So that's very 1980 and 1990. It's a big market. We found that there's more than 26 million people that are working part-time jobs every year. And that's a statistic. Probably that's even, the number is probably higher than that. It's more than $300 billion in that part-time job market. And the question is why is the right time now to do something that we're doing is that the on-demand economy is on the rise. People are using Uber, Airbnb, and other apps that are on demand. Our idea of the solution is that we have two sides. We have businesses and we have employees. We need to connect those two. And the solution for that is a very simple app that will connect those two and match those two to find the best match for doing business. So this is the design of our app. It's very simple. It's, as Alex said, it's Google Maps with pins. So yeah, that's the truth. But there's much more into it. The main features that we are using to do the matching between businesses and employees is the interests of the people and the geolocation. We believe that's very important to, especially for students, to find jobs very close to their home, because they can make more money than traveling for an hour or so. So they're losing money if they travel. And if we match those interests, what they want to do with the businesses that need those people, then we'll create some kind of satisfaction, job satisfaction. And the third very important thing of our app is that we're going to use push notifications. So people, we're not the job board. We don't want people to search for jobs. We want to push the jobs to them. So if you're close to a place where there's an available job, you'll get a push notification and you can go there and find a job very, very easily and very quickly. Currently, our go-to-market strategy is that we are targeting students. Students make the most of the 26 million of people that are looking for part-time jobs yearly. And the good thing is that students are using smartphones. 90% of them are using smartphones, and they're early adopters, so we can push the technology to them very easily. Our target market is the US because of the laws. It's very simple to do something like this there. We cannot do that in Europe or Serbia or anywhere else. And for the businesses, we're targeting small and medium businesses, mostly bars and restaurants, because they have a large need for part-time employees. And also we're targeting some startups like Uber and Lyft. We want them to use our app to find drivers and whatever they need. There are four of us currently. We have an iOS developer, Pavle, he's also here. We have a PHP developer, we have designer, and me, I'm the biz developer of the whole thing. This is the roadmap we're trying to achieve. We're going to launch an MVP in a few days. And until December, we're going to do the growth thing. We'll try to grow. And by the end of December, we want to have at least 1,000 daily active users. So currently we have done the biz development, an early biz development. We know what people need, we know what they want. We have a landing page where we attract signups, and we have more than 40 signups in the last month or so. And we're doing the MVP, we're already at 90% of the MVP, so it's gonna launch in a few days or a week at top. We're looking for seed investment. The money that people will invest will be used to grow. We need that money to grow, to attract more people, and to reach our goal of 1,000 daily active users by the end of the year. So let's disrupt the part-time job market. That's our idea. Thank you.
Dobar dan svima. Ja sam Vuk. Ovo je Cargo, mobilna aplikacija koja će vam olakšati urban gradski prevoz. So, what's your problem? The ultimate transportation There's no such thing. In some cities, it works. Subway works better than the taxi. Buses work better than the subway. What about Belgrade? So obviously, we don't have subway in this city. So we rely on the famous Bus Plus or GSP and taxi to get around town. Usually, the problem with the taxi is the price. Usually, that's the one biggest thing that we notice that people are crying about before they or after they take a taxi. Hassle. I don't know what's the last time you've been on these buses around town. I have, and it's much better now than it used to be, but still not up to par with other European cities. And service versus attitude. So, as some would say, tell me about it. You know, it's an interesting thing. I'm talking about specifically a taxi industry. When you get in the cab, instead of relieving your problems, you get to hear more of the driver's problems. So there is a better way, and this is why Cargo is here. You simply click to order a ride once you download and register, obviously. Our rides are meant for you to enjoy, so we are trying to offer a new experience in getting from point A to point B. Pay as you go system. So as of today, you have a chance to finally use PayPal and all of their advantages within the app. So today you can fire up Cargo app, pay or buy some credit and order a ride, get in the car and get out once you're there. It's as easy as that. There's no extra clicking, confirming. As you leave the car, you get the receipt to your email. And as well, I would like to point out our rating system, which is not live yet. We are still testing internally, but this is offering you an option to test, to rate every driver that gives you a ride. We are trying to ensure the highest quality for each of the rides our passengers receive. So why do we do it now? Well, obviously timing is everything. And these are some of the interview answers that we got from Belgrade citizens. A lot of them are frustrated with the current status where they can't have an option to choose, obviously relieved of some freedoms. So generally, what we have noticed in Belgrade, in this region, people are open to try new things and open to new technology. And I will talk about our experience so far, but we have seen similar services to this before in Belgrade. Unfortunately, they had to shut down due to various other reasons, but people were generally and honestly interested in trying new things before there was an outburst of these type of services in the West. So we are trying to change the needs of people to get around town with our service Cargo. When we talk about the market that we are facing in Belgrade, it's a pretty decent size. It's not something of a small figure. In our research, we found that people spend around 60 million euros on taxi rides in Belgrade. This includes both domestic and international. This figure on Bus Plus is not confirmed, but our estimates are that people spend around 100 million on Bus Plus tickets, so bus tickets for public transportation. And exclusive market, this is something very interesting, and it's a niche market that no one really tapped into and offered to a wide public. This is what we're trying to do as well in our app. So the competition that you see are on the left are all the companies that are present here in Belgrade now. Our biggest competition, I would say, is the public transportation and the taxis. We have around 10,000 of those in the city of Belgrade. And concurrence, as the French would say. So these are some of the services that have a similar app to ours. And they're very successful. Obviously, they raised a lot of money in the recent past. I would differentiate between the ones on the left and the ones on the right. We are more of a Uber-like service, Lyft. And I think so far, the only in Europe that have a service where we charge the customer the whole amount, the whole fee, and then we pay out the partner driver. In other apps on the right, you still have to use cash for every ride. So what we are trying to do and accomplish globally that's different from everyone else is our mini class. So that's a small car that can drive one or two people that consumes a lot less gas. And we think we can be competitive with the rest of the competition, even in those markets where they operate. So this is App Cargo. This is probably the only way you will be able to find this on App Store and Play Store. Cargo is a very common word, but we were looking for something that's both one word, international, and associates with a car. This is how our app looks like. So we have three classes of vehicles, mini, economy, and elite. And the price, of course, depends on the class that you pick. We also have a fare estimation where you can enter your destination and you can see how much your fare is going to be before you actually order a ride. So where do we go next from here? Hopefully to Rome and Vienna as our next city targets. Why Rome and Vienna? In our research, we found that it doesn't make much sense for us to go to another Serbian city within Serbia due to the low taxi fare in those cities. However, we decided to go to Vienna, or we're still thinking about it, working on it, because it has a big Serbian population and also has every other way of transportation, and all of them are profitable. In Rome, because of the number of tourists, Rome has over 25 million tourists per year, and we also have some good connections on the ground. In Asia, these are interesting markets for us due to one of our founders, so we are going to be testing our service over there too. So our business model is transaction based. We make money on revenue share with the partner driver. For each transaction, it is 20% of the fare. We want to focus on high volume and low fare and pretty much become the service that's going to substitute ownership of your car. And of course, in Belgrade, we are trying to change the status quo and offer something different. So what I'll talk about the team. We have six founders, out of which one programmer and one designer. We have, yes, in four countries, we are spread across the globe. One is in the US, one is in India, and one in Italy, and the rest of us are here. We have four salesmen, PR and marketing professional who is part of the team as well, helping us out, and of course, ICT Hub mentoring, which we appreciate. Our traction, so this was only an idea about eight months ago. We opened up a company in March, and we have 50 downloads as of today. And we just made 86 euros, so hooray. We were featured today on Netokracia and Startit tech blogs. So what we're looking for an angel investment. I wouldn't talk about the size right now, but we are not only looking for a check, we are looking for someone who can enter to other countries, other cities, people who have done this before that can help out both with their connections and, of course, the money. So also in Belgrade, we're looking for B2B introductions where we would like to speak to companies who are spending nice amounts for urban transportation. And of course, looking for advising. So if you have an idea that you would like to tell us, to share maybe some experience that you have from abroad with this kind of service, that's always welcome.
Dobro večer svima, moje ime je Biljana i ja ću prezentovati na engleskom jeziku. So hello and welcome. Again, my name is Biljana and I would like to present the field skill, a better way to run your field service business. There are more than 200,000 field service companies just in the United States, out and about every day doing everything, from trying to fix your boiler, maintaining your air conditioner, mowing your backyard, to providing services and parts to jet engines. What do they all have in common is the lack of control. So imagine yourself running a field service company with 15 technicians. How are you going to manage them? Are you going to use pen and papers, sheets and notes? Of course not, because that is inefficient and time-consuming. So we validated this statement with over 100 small field service companies from the United States through intensive interviews and research, and they all say the same. Lack of control leads to inefficiency, and at the bottom line, company is losing money. So why still majority of them is still using piles of papers, notes, some of them are using Excel spreadsheets. This is why we developed a field skill, to help them dish the notes, sheets and papers, to help them know in every moment, just few clicks away, where are their technicians, what is their work schedule, how much time and material each one of them spent for every service they provided. And not just that, they can know their customers, their paying balance, their preferences, and their work history. So you may wonder how actually big is this market? Well, more than 80% of the all field service companies in the United States are small companies with average of 10 employees. And those are the companies that we target. And on the other side, investment in the field service management software, like FieldSkill, we jumped from the last $1.58 billion to $3.52 billion by 2019. Why this is happening is because the field service companies are rapidly enhancing technology, and they don't want longer to use CRM and ERP systems. They want a tailored fit solution for them. So here is where we see our chance. Our business model is quite simple. We charge our clients with $14 per seat per month, and we have three paid add-ons. We offer a 1 month free trial to get them started. Few words about our competition. Beside the CRM and ERP system, such as SAP and Sugar, our two key competitors are Jobber and Kickserv. As we target the same market, they more focus on business automation, as we focus on business transparency and control, and automated processes is just one of the ways we tend to do this. This is the core team behind FieldSkill. We have Alexander Zajc, he is in charge of user experience, Miloš Mirić in charge of back-end development, and I am doing the business development. I would like to thank you for your attention. Thank you for supporting FieldSkill.
Okay, people, we're here to present you a new model for business consulting. Actually, we're here to talk about Learn to Win2, and since we don't have much time, I just extracted some news from the 2015 and 2016. You can read those news afterwards in the future slides. But I'm going to talk about all the fuss that Learn to Win2 made in a previous year. And I'm talking about 2015, since now is February of 2016. Okay, remember that. Okay, so back in the 2015, we realized that there's no real criteria to choose a consulting firm. Why? Because there was so much subjectivity in that market. There were so many long-term relationships. I mean, who knows who, etc. There were like, companies were selling portfolios. They're not selling what you really need. So we tested the internet. So we tested like 42 Q&A websites and we interviewed 8 consulting firms. Okay. And we realized that Market needs Learn to Intu. Learn to Intu is a Q&A way to choose or test your business consultants and do that anonymously. Now, why anonymously? Because back in the 2013, I'm really mixing years. Back in the 2013, the LinkedIn answers were closed. Okay, the LinkedIn chose to close the answers because the business users didn't want to ask the questions. Why? Because they were afraid that somebody will know that they don't know it. Okay, so we built on that. I mean, LinkedIn closed it as a niche. I mean, that answer thing was a niche. I mean, niche, a market that is third growing industry and it has like more than 400 billion revenue and 575 new customers expected, consulting jobs in current decade. I mean, that's a niche I would like to work in. Okay, so we have a competition, of course. Competitions are business sections of Q&A websites, but the point is that they're not certified. And we have like emails from consulting firms, which are certified, of course, but they just time consuming, okay. So what we did, we made a Learn to Win 2 to connect consulting firms and big companies. Here are the consulting firms, some big consulting firms. Here are some big companies. I work for those, I consider them big, okay? And way to test consultants. Consulting firms are testing their employees and big companies are testing consultants they're working with. Okay, people who are doing that is me, Mirko Kiković, as a manager, Stefan Cojić as a future of development, and Nebojša Milić, experienced developer who is a tester of all this program. As you see, news of February 2016 is that Learn to Win 2 seeks new designer because all this model was based on Ogilvy model of marketing and website that was used in 2015. It's so 2015. So basically the rest of the team is the ICT Hub and those people that we're working with, those consulting Tetra Paks and famous great guys from Toriel, I must say that Learn to Win 2 is an ICT hub, is a place where I learn a lot and where I want my friends. So that's it.
Po cenu da ispademo hipsteri, mi ćemo prezentovati i pričati na srpskom, pa sad kako bude ovo. Okay. Ja sam Đorđe, ovo je Ivan. Mi trenutno radimo na jednoj aplikaciji, to je servisu Nightlifer. To je jedna aplikacija koja bi trebala bude vodič i rating sistem za noćni život.
Jel te, noćni život. Sad slobodno možemo kažemo da u ovom trenutku gotovo svaki mladi čovjek pored standardnog ovog dosadnog dnevnog života ima svoj noćni život. Kako imamo odelo za posao, odelo za tokom dana, tako imamo isto neka odela koje nosimo samo na izlazcima. A s druge strane, jel te, i kako imamo torbe, šminke i sve ostalo za preko dana za posao, imamo sve to isto i za, jel te, samo noćni život.
Ovako, samo prema nekim procenama za barove i klubove u Americi oko 25 milijardi dolara se potroši godišnje, tako da jedan mali deo toga nije toliko mali. Ono što je interesantno je da mi nismo ni prvi ni posljednji koji su pokušali ovo, tako da...
Da, mislim, na Google Play Store ima desetina aplikacija koje su jasno, jel te uvidjeli to da ima to je ta velika cifra koja može da se uzme, ta velika cifra koju ljudi koriste svake godine i koji su hteli da uđu u taj market, da zarade pare tokom prilikom neke aplikacije. Što smo uvidjeli za sve te slične aplikacije jeste da kao prvo veoma brzo dobiju neki inicijalni broj korisnika, a kao drugo veoma brzo izgube taj inicijalni broj korisnika. Što dovodi do toga da, jel te, pretpostavka je da ljudi ipak traže tako neku aplikaciju, nešto će im pomoći u noćnom životu da odluče na koji način da izađu negdje ili da se organizuju tokom večernjih sati. A s druge strane, da sve te aplikacije nisu vjerojatno potrošile dovoljno vremena da naprave nešto savršeno, nešto će ljudi koristiti svakog dana. Odnosno da zadrže te korisnike i da ih upoznaju dovoljno dobro s tom aplikacijom kako bi ta aplikacija postala, jel te, barem na nedeljnom nivou nešto će oni koristiti.
E sad, tu smo opet pristupili na jedan malo drugačiji način, osim da odmah napravimo nešto, izbacimo, skupimo korisnike pa ih izgubimo zato što nemamo fičere. Krenuli smo sa fazama testiranja, prvo smo pričali sa nekim našim poznanicima, pa smo pustili neke upitnike
Nakon toga smo napravili ovaj Facebook quiz, koji je imao za cilj da, ovaj, pored toga da saznamo sve ovaj, navike potencijalnih korisnika, da i testiramo koliko su oni voljni ovaj, za neke buduće feature, poput šerovanja tih sadržaja, poput ovaj, javljanja drugovima o takvim nekim stvarima. Ono što je interesantno, smo iz tog Facebook quiza smo tu inicijalnu grupu ovaj, uspeli da učetvorostručimo, samo zahvaljujući ovaj, time što smo pustili među neke ljude, na kraju se nakupila se ta inicijalna grupa koju smo krenuli učetvorostručila.
Da, još jedna zanimljiva stvar oko onog Facebook viza jeste da je preko 50% ljudi koje je dobilo odgovor na taj Facebook viz šerovalo to, a preko 75% ljudi koje je dobilo odgovor da su partiji manjak isto to šerovalo na Facebooku. Što je nam i dokazalo da ljudi žele takve stvari da šeruju na Facebooku bez nekog velikog bitnog razloga. Onda smo, posle toga smo počeli sa radom na našoj Android aplikaciji. Android aplikacija je nativna na potpunosti, koja ima neke osnovne feature. I sad je trenutno u beta 1 testing krug. Naš dalji plan jeste da imamo nekoliko testing krugova, zato što ova aplikacija kao aplikacija ne može da bude od bilo kakve koristi, osim ako vaši prijatelji ne koriste aplikaciju. Mi smo pristupili problemu pravljenja savršene aplikacije tako što smo prvu beta aplikaciju pustili u jednu studentsku organizaciju i sad skupljamo feature, feedback od svih tih ljudi, šta trebamo da napravimo, kako trebamo da napravimo i izbegavamo bugove. Kad usavršujemo ovaj prvi stage, prelazimo, širimo aplikaciju na drugu studentsku organizaciju, dodajemo još jednu studentsku organizaciju, radimo sve ponovo, dodajemo treću i tako dalje.
Tako da bismo do oktobra trebali da imamo ovaj jedan MVP koji može se pustiti u javnost.
Dobro večer, ja sam Mijomir Radovanović i govorim ispred firme Orion Telekom, koja je i osnivač i pokrovitelj ICT Hub-a. Tako da mi, za razliku od svih ostalih timova, mi nismo start-uperi, mi smo samo jedan razvojni tim koji se preselio iz kruga fabrike koja je daleko odavde u ovaj mirni prostor koji nam omogućuje da razvijamo svoju aplikaciju. Priznam, nismo se spremili za ovakvu vrstu prezentacije kao svi ostali, kroz slajdove, kroz PowerPoint, jer je to sve već prošlo na konferenciji štampu koju je Orion imao pre 3 nedelje. S druge strane, ja nisam ni marketing, ni komercijal Oriona da bih govorio s te strane aplikacije. Ja sam jednostavno neko ko je zadužen da ta aplikacija funkcioniše ispravno i da Orion u svemu tome ima veći broj korisnika. Verovatno znate da je Orion Telekom prvi alternativni fiksni operator u Srbiji, to jeste da smo posle Telekoma Srbije mi dobili prvu licencu za fiksnu telefoniju. I kao i sve druge usluge koje Orion pruža, i tu je bio pokušaj da se napravi nešto novo, inventivno, tako da smo pokušali da redefinišemo uopšte pojam fiksne telefonije i da fiksni telefon i fiksni broj odvojimo od nečega što su kablovi, žice i aparati, nego da sve to preselimo na tehnologiju koja se ima sada dostupna i svako je koristi, a to su mobilni telefoni. Dakle, naš proizvod koji se zove Ring Plus je naslednik jedne stare aplikacije koja je izašla pre 3 godine, i Ring Plus je zapravo fiksni telefon na mobilnom uređaju. U ovom trenutku mi imamo samo verziju za Android, ali započet je i razvoj verzije za iOS, na kraju će biti i Windows, tako ćemo pokriti celu tu paletu mobilnih uređaja. Aplikacija trenutno funkcioniše u 2 režima, to je prepaid i postpaid. Dakle, svako ko skine aplikaciju sa Play Store-a, ona je već 3 meseca dostupna na Play Store-u, ima mogućnost da bira da li je novi korisnik telefonije ili je već postojeći korisnik Orion fiksne telefonije. Ukoliko je novi korisnik, aplikacija u nekoliko koraka na vrlo jednostavan način konfiguriše samu sebe i korisniku se dodali fiksni broj po principu prepaid. Tako da smo i tu uveli nešto novo, a to je prepaid fiksna telefonija koja trenutno ne postoji ovde u regionu. S druge strane, Orion ne samo da je fiksni operator, nego je i SMS operator, tako da aplikacija vam omogućuje da sa fiksnog broja razmenjujete SMS-ove sa svim domaćim mobilnim operatorima i to u ovom trenutku po ceni od 0 dinara, odnosno besplatno. I ono što, ako ste korisnik Orion fiksne telefonije, vi dobijete da isti broj koji imate kod kuće na svom mobilnom telefonu. Tako da, gde god se nalazite, vi ste dostupni na onom fiksnom broju koji je nekada bio vezan isključivo za prostor kancelarije ili stana. Kažem, aplikacija je veoma jednostavna za korišćenje, zamišljena da bude takva, jednostavna, dakle, možete da telefonirate, možete da šaljete poruke, možete da šaljete SMS-ove, možete da razmenjujete multimedijalne sadržaje i to je to. Dakle, jednostavnost u nečemu što radi brzo i efikasno jeste bila ideja Orion Telekoma kada je i krenuo u razvoj ove aplikacije. Ima mogućnost, naravno, i slanja pozivnica i same aplikacije, tako da kogod je zadovoljan, on je u prilici da pošalje svojim prijateljima preko SMS-a sa fiksnog broja pozivnicu da tu aplikaciju instalira, proba i dalje širi. To je to što bih ja u ovom trenutku mogao da kažem. Vezano za aplikaciju, ono što je meni daleko bitnije, jer aplikaciju možete da probate da sami vidite kako vam se čini, kako funkcioniše, ono što je bitnije to je da je Orion, kažem, kao osnivač ovog huba i pokrovitelj, zapravo prva velika firma u Srbiji koja je svoj development team izdvojila u ovakav jedan prostor i što se prvo pokazalo kao veoma efikasno, jer je sam naš rad postao daleko produktivniji i brži, a i daje, eto, motivaciju ostalim velikim kompanijama da to isto urade sa svojim razvojnim timovima. Hvala.
Ćao svima, ja sam spremao na engleskom prezentaciju, ali probat ću na ovom englesko-srpskom da vidimo kako to funkcioniše. Ja sam deo tima Toril i mi radimo na povezivanju svih ljudi koji prave igre, tako što pravimo freelancing platformu koja je fokusirana samo na game development. Možda svi znate koliko je game industrija velika, možda ne znate, svakako će ove godine verovatno dostići oko 100 milijardi dolara i to je samo jedan od razloga zašto je game development, zašto je game development tako unosna industrija i zašto je uopšte biti game developer jedna od dobrih stvari. Samo na LinkedInu ima više od milijon ljudi koji prave igre i sve više njih su freelanceri i to su baš ljudi koji će koristiti Toril. Naravno, postoje druge freelancing platforme, nijedna od njih nije fokusirana na game development. I takođe, kada hoćete da pravite igru, to ne može da može, ali za ozbiljnije stvari treba vam ceo tim. Ako hoćete da nađete ceo tim, kako bi to uradili? Odete na jednu od ovih platformi i kažete, recimo, vam treba programer. I postavite projekat, definišete tačno šta vam treba, ljudi se prijave, vi pogledate njihovu prošlost, izaberete koji je najbolji, ako vam se svidi, angažujete. Onda odete na drugu platformu gde tražite čoveka za zvuk, opet postavite projekat, tražite istu stvar, radite, pa kad svim dogovorite, odete na treću platformu i tamo isto to uradite i onda njih morate sve da to spojite u jedan tim. Mi smo odlučili to da pojednostavimo i napravili smo Toril gde možete da postavite jedan projekat gde može da se prijavi ceo tim, ljudi mogu da se prijavi kao individualci i kao već tim koji je unapred ustanovljen. Ono što mi hoćemo da uradimo je da pružimo najbolje game developere koji će detaljno proći kroz naš proces testiranja, uštedimo vreme tako što možete da nađete ceo tim na jednom mestu i pružimo bezbednost tako što ćemo biti pouzdan partner koji će se pobrinuti da će svaki projekat biti završen do kraja. Naš plan je da uzimamo procena 3 do 9% po svakom završenom projektu i procenjujemo da nam to sa oko 2000 projekata mesečno može doneti oko 500.000 dolara u prvoj godini posle. Ono što sada radimo je kontaktiramo marketinške agencije koje prave proste igre za svoje klijente kako kao loyalty programe, tako i u cilju promocije. I oni obično prave oko jednu igru nedeljno, koja je u proseku oko 500 do 700 dolara cene. A s druge strane, imamo timove, imamo trenutno 8 studija koji su spremni da prave igre i naš cilj je da budemo neko koji će sve to da poveže. Ovo je tim koji radi na tome, Petar i ja smo, pored toga što smo developeri, smo i game developeri, Aleksandar ima oko 10 godina iskustva u prodaji i marketingu i Nikola koji je naš dizajner, koji je super. Aj dobro, dizajner. On je uradio sve ovo. Mislim, slajdovi što. Trenutno imamo preko 100 korisnika i oko 10 projekata, hobi projekata na našem sajtu sada. gde možete da dođete i da kažete hoću da napravim takvu i takvu igru, treba mi developer ili dizajner i tu može tim da se spoji. Ono što sada radimo je na prikupljanju novih korisnika i customer developmentu i tražimo partnere i mentore koji mogu da nas povežu sa kompanijama koje rade na izradi igara i koji imaju potrebe za izvođenje igara. I hvala što ste slušali.
Moje ime je Novi, u narednih par minuta reći ću vam nešto više o Iskra softveru za izradu web sajtova za male i srednje preduzeće. Možda su vam poznati ovi brojevi, ove godine broj korisnika koji pristupaju internetu preko uređaja telefona i tableta je dostigao 50% i dalje veoma brzo raste. Takođe, nedavno je Google uveo novu politiku po kojoj penalizuju pretragama sve sajtove koji nisu optimizovani za uređaje. Ako pogledamo neke brojeve vezane za srpsko tržište, po podacima APR-a ima 300.000 registrovanih kompanija. Većina tih kompanija nema sajtove optimizovane za uređaje, a po našem nekom malom istraživanju više od 70% bi želelo da napravi takav sajt, mada misle da bi bilo previše skupo to odraditi. Zato mi predstavljamo naš softver i servis za izradu web sajtova. Osim brze izrade responsivnog web sajta optimizovanog za pretraživače, u naš paket usluga ulazi i hosting, takođe listing na Google My Business, o kome ću za minut reći nešto više, domen po izboru korisnika, mesečno održavanje i 7 dana dostupan servis za klijente za pomoć. Sve to po ceni trenutnoj koju sada vidite. Inače, ovaj softver razvijamo u dve faze. Trenutno smo u prvoj fazi, gde još uvek nismo zvanično odradili taj softver koji će biti dostupan svima i preko koga će ljudi koji ne znaju, ne poznaju kod, moći na vizualan način da izrade web sajt. Mi pratimo software as a service business model, to jest software kao servis. Trenutno imamo dve vrste naloga koji se mesečno plaćaju i još nudimo neke usluge po meri kao što su razvoj brenda i tako nešto slično. Na ovom grafiku možete videti naš profit. Sa 30 korisnika smo na nuli, sa 100 korisnika blizu 50% nam je profit, a sa 1000 korisnika oko 80%. Ovo je sve vezano za ovu prvu fazu. U drugoj fazi, kada softver bude gotov, profit će biti znatno veći, tako da na 1000 korisnika bit će preko 95%. Iako još uvek nismo zvanično lansirali, već imamo prve klijente u Kini i nekoliko u Srbiji i sklopili smo nekoliko strateških partnerstava sa regionalnom privrednom komorom za koju se nadamo da će biti glavni kanal akvizicije klijenata. Angela Huang Shui je moj prijatelj iz Kine, neko sa kim sam dugo radio, ona je preduzetnik i veoma je bitna za tržište u Hong Kongu i Shenzhenu. I Leftor deo Tuzla je developerska firma, oni razvijaju softver i već su imali iskustva sa nekim sličnim softverom kao što mi radimo, tako da su bitni za nas jer imaju iskustvo koje nam donose. Pozitivan feedback koji imamo od agencija koje se bave online marketingom, koji kažu da ako uspemo u našoj nameri, njima ćemo olakšati posao. I takođe, listing na Google Business, My Businessu, to je standardni deo našeg paketa, gde informacije o kompaniji mi predajemo Google-u, tako da biznis je dostupan u pretragama, na Google Plusu i na mapama. Znači, veća je eksponiranost kompanije koje su na ovoj listi, Google My Business. Konkurencija, ovo su neki serveri, servisi, to je softver koji je sličan onome što mi radimo, mada oni nam nisu direktna konkurencija, jer mi takođe nudimo klijentima da za njih uradimo sajt. Naprimjer, ako odete na Squarespace i vidite znači, kako to sve funkcioniše, vidjet ćete neke template njihove koji su svi onako lepi i skockani, ali zato kada pogledate šta su stvarno ljudi radili, to baš i nije toliko lepo. Tako da neko ko možda nema osjećaj taj vizuelni može nama da prepusti da odradimo sajt. Jedina direktna konkurencija su nam freelanceri, mada sa freelancerima nekad imate dobro, nekad loše iskustvo. Ljudi koji su u core timu ovog projekta, to sam ja, Dimitrije Ostojić. I trenutno se trudimo da razvijemo svest na srpskom tržištu o neophodnosti tog web sajta optimizovanih za uređaje i da stvorimo nove kanale akvizicije klijenata. Hvala vam.
ja sam Dejan Ranđić, ja sam jedan od osnivača ICT Hub-a, pored već pomenutih ljudi iz Orion Telekoma. I praktično sa ovim događajem današnjim smo ušli u nekakav proces rekapitulacije onoga što je rađeno u prethodnim mesecima. Formalno gledano, godinu dana od početka rada ICT Hub-a će biti tek krajem oktobra meseca, ali obzirom da smo sada već ušli u neki ciklus razgovora sa budućim i starim budućim korisnicima ICT Hub-a, praktično sada počinjemo taj proces rekapitulacije. Mislim da je danas bio jako dobar presek onoga što jeste bio ICT Hub, zato što ono što smo se i trudili, ili bolje da kažem ono što smo priželjkivali, a to se na kraju i desilo, to je da imamo jednu dosta šarenu sliku u pozitivnom smislu ljudi koji i projekata koji su se u ovih prethodnih 8-9 meseci razvijali u ICT Hub-u. Kroz ICT Hub je prošlo negde oko, Kosta zna te podatke jako bolje, zato što on je taj koji je i radio i živeo ovde sa vama, negde oko 50 i nešto ljudi, 16 projekata i timova, ako se ne varam. I mislim da mi, pre svega, koji smo ovo pokrenuli, možemo budemo zadovoljni pre svega sa onim što ste vi za sebe ovde uradili, ukoliko smo kroz ICT Hub makar delić pomogli da pogurate svoje projekte i da uradite ono što ste uradili možda za mrvicu bolje nego što bi uradili da niste bili ovde, to je nešto što je naše veliko zadovoljstvo. Postavili smo na početku funkcionisanja i kada smo pokrenuli ICT Hub neke možda i relativno visoke ciljeve, ja se nadam i vreme će pokazati da smo ih verovatno u ovoj godini makar u nekoj dobroj meri ostvarili, ali zaista nije fraza, nastavljamo sa tim. Sledeće godine, pored nastavka funkcionisanja ICT Hub-a, ono što smo postavili, to su dva neka važna i ne tako mala cilja. Jedan je da, pored onoga što je osnovni program i osnovna delatnost ICT Hub-a, to je da dnevno radimo sa onim ljudima koji će biti ovde fizički, a mislim da ćemo gledati da podignemo lestvicu na bazi nekih iskustava iz ove godine sa aspekta broja ljudi. Ono što je jako važno, to je da pokušamo da makar deo onoga što imaju kao mogućnost ljudi koji su u ICT Hub-u da priuštimo ljudima koji ne mogu da budu ovde fizički, jer ono što je velika istina, to je da makar po ovom pitanju postoji velika razlika i neko bi mogao da kaže diskriminacija između ljudi koji su u Beogradu i ljudi koji nisu u Beogradu. Mi smo ovde u prethodnoj godini imali jednog čoveka koji je se odlučio i imao mogućnosti da provede godinu dana van svog mesta gde živi i da provede ovde u ICT Hub-u, ali u suštini najveći broj ljudi nema takve mogućnosti i svi oni ljudi koji žive u nekom, da li Vršcu, da li Valjevu, da li Leskovcu i tako dalje, oni su u velikoj meri uskraćeni. I ono što je jedan od ciljeva i projekata, to je da praktično ICT Hub sa određenim svojim segmentima pokušamo da približimo njima. Druga možda još važnija stvar, to je da pronađemo način koji bi bio najbolji za sami korisnik ICT Hub, ali ne odnosi se samo na njih, to je da pređemo i da otvorimo dodatnu fazu, to je ta faza investiranja, i da pored toga što smo u prethodnih 8 ili 9 meseci i tekako radili na povezivanju naših timova sa potencijalnim investitorima, to je da pokušamo da animiramo neke ljude da aktivnije kroz ICT Hub krenu da vrše tu ulogu investitora, zato što mislim da i duboko verujem da neće biti razvoja tržišta, start-upova i kompletnog ekosistema bez razvoja domaćih investitora koji sada u velikoj meri nedostaju, jer su orijentisani pre svega na nešto što je po njihovom mišljenju mnogo više opipljivo. Nastavljamo, ono što za kraj želim da kažem, to je da i zaista volio bih da shvatite da je potpunost i iskrenost naše strane, vi ste ICT Hub i to je ono što je pravilo vrednost ICT Hub-a u ovom periodu i nadam se da ćete nastaviti da budete ICT Hub kao bivši i budući korisnici. Ovo nije jedini događaj, nastavljamo sa ovim. 1. jula imamo nešto što je takođe, nadam se da će biti dosta dobro, to je čovjek iz GoPro-a, jedan od direktora, dolazi da da, da predstavi kako su oni to radili. Siguran sam da tokom leta, odnosno krajem leta, da će biti još neki ovakav događaj, tako da, a onda idemo u novu sezonu. Hvala vam puno.
ICT Hub je osnovan u novembru 2014. godine. Naša ideja je bila da pokušamo na jednom mestu da spojimo mlade ljude koji žele da imaju svoje tehnološke kompanije i sa druge strane ljude koji su u tome već uspeli i koji mogu da im pruže odgovarajuće savete.
Stanari ICT Hub-a su jednim delom ili možda najvećim delom kao ljudi koji tek počinju sa svojom preduzetničkom karijerom.
To su ljudi koji imaju 20 godina i nekako nisam imala prilike da upoznam tako mlade i ambiciozne ljude.
Mi smo zapravo započeli ideju i radili smo je od kuće koliko god smo mogli. U ICT Hubu smo zapravo samo dobili boost.
Svi imamo full-time poslove i ovde dolazimo nakon našeg radnog vremena i radimo takozvanu noćnu smenu.
I subotom i nedeljom oni su najčešće ovde, zato što ima dosta njih koji su ili studenti ili rade, pa im je najlakše vikendom da budu ovde. Postoje dve konferencijske sale u Hubu. Imaju relax sobu gde se opuštaju i gde vole da imaju malo neformalnije sastanke.
Taj moment gde ja dođem ovde i okružen sa ljudima koji pozitivno razmišljaju, s kojima mogu normalno da pričam o stvarima koje mene u tom trenutku muče vezano za moj startup.
Eto, to je neki osnovni, da kažem, taj osjećaj druženja koji postoji u srednjoj školi, nekog neiskvarenog, čistog, znači to je nešto što sam ponovo doživio u ICT Hubu.
Ja sam sa ETF-a i tu sam naučio neke druge stvari. Kada pokrećeš svoj posao, mora da znaš i stvari te biznis strane.
Verujemo da mladi preduzetnici znaju svoj posao koji je najčešće programiranje, koji je tehnički prirode i da im najviše pomoći treba u stvari upravo u plasmanu proizvoda.
Ovde su uvek mentori, ljudi koji tu rade, koji su spremni da pomognu. Ako ne, imaju veliku mrežu ljudi koji su već radili ranije nešto slično ono što ja radim i uvek mogu da pitam bilo koga od njih.
Ključni rezultat je da smo okupili preko 40 mladih preduzetnika koji rade na 15 perspektivnih projekata. Da su neki od naših stanara već dobili početne investicije, neki su osvajali nagrade na startup takmičenjima. Organizovali smo preko 30 edukativnih radionica, okupili preko 40 mentora, zainteresovali više mladih ljudi da postanu preduzetnici.
Da, ima da se radi, da, znači dosta je posla, trebaju rokovi da se ispune, ali ideš da radiš ono što voliš.
Svi mladi ljudi mi preporučuju svakako da krenu da rade nešto sami, samostalno. Neće svako uspeti, ali i kroz taj neuspeh će puno toga naučiti.
Ne postoji neuspeh. Sve su lekcije, što pre krenu bilo šta da rade, pre će izvući nešto dobro iz toga.